Bartok learnt many things from the study of ethnic music through recording, not least of which were ways of treating the musical language itself that were not bound by the old rules of rhythm, harmony and melody that they'd been brought up on. All composers started to hear music differently. Over the course of the century, one form of music above all others came to exert its influence on European music, thanks to Edison's ingenious invention. This music was, of course, African. The English composer David Fanshawe toured Africa, the Middle East and the Pacific in the 60s, 70s and 80s, compiling a vast library of tapes of tribal music. Fanshawe's African Sanctus mixes Western and African music using his tapes with live instruments and singers.
The backing track was recorded 30 years ago in Uganda, so it's a traditional tribal dance. Yeah. It's a Bwala dance, which is a welcome, of the Acholi tribe. And I am trying to synchronize what I am hearing in my head, which is full choir, with the tape. One, two, three. I started out as a traveller with a notebook and a camera, and then I used to hear sounds in the markets and the bazaars and the churches and wherever I was, I'd hear strange sounds that, you know, I had not heard before. Yeah. Then that led me to think, huh, I better record them for posterity. And then that led me to think, but I'm a composer, I'm so inspired, I want to join in, I want to experiment with this. I suppose I'm a kind of early sampler, if you like. You know, I was sampling the world. It seems to me that all music is related. All human beings, regardless of colour, race, creed, nationality, we are all interrelated musically. We have a soul, and that soul is the universe of music, the universality of music. That's how it appears to me. And this is why I feel I can, you know, make a comment as a composer, join in, comment on, and retain the essence of, hopefully, the beauty of pure music, pure sound.
The whole planet came to experience African roots through the popular music of Black America. The rhythm, soul, and energy of African music, as carried across to the Americas by 2 million slaves, gave birth to wave after wave of new musical forms and styles, from jazz to hip-hop, from ragtime to jungle, from the blues to Motown.
Recording took the music of Black America out of tiny bars and clubs, out of remote neighborhood churches, out of deprived ghettos, and into the homes and lives of the rest of the planet.
From Stravinsky and Ravel onwards, many composers from the European classical tradition have succumbed to the power of Afro-American music. But it hasn't all been a one-way street. Black popular musicians were in turn influenced by the classics. In the last 40 or so years, though, one astonishing development above all others has borne witness to the cross-fertilization that Edison's Big Bang brought to life.
Avant-garde composers from a classical background were engaged in experiments in sound and technology that were to have an equally profound effect on popular music. In the 1950s, experimental composers like Karlheinz Stockhausen began to incorporate new, non-instrumental sounds into their compositions. They pioneered electronic music, synthesizers, and perhaps most crucially of all, the technique known as sampling. They probably don't know it, but every DJ in the world is now mixing dance music with the help of these techniques. Digital sampling is the love child of recording and music. Few composers have been as intrigued by its possibilities and as key to its development as the brilliant New Yorker Steve Reich.
The most likely candidate for working with tape to my ear was the human voice. And when you do that with a voice, with a voice, with a voice, you begin to hear the pitch. And the music of the speech becomes equal to the meaning. It's as if you, by the repetition, you jack up the musical parameter.
For me, the most moving work to attempt the blend of speech, tape, and live performance is Reich's 1988 masterwork, Different Trains, a haunting and powerful evocation of his childhood and a reflection on the American Jewish experience.
I don't know how, you know, it popped into my mind, but I began thinking about my own past, as my childhood, and about these train trips that I took as a child. Since my parents had divorced when I was 1 year old, my mother had gone to Los Angeles. She was a singer. My father remained in New York City. He was a lawyer. And from the age of 1 to the age of about 5, when I had to start going to school, I used to go back and spend 6 months in New York, 6 months in Los Angeles.
Crack train from New York.
The sampled voices are those of Reich's governess, who accompanied him on his long journeys, and an elderly Pullman porter.
On the extra border, when we run to Chicago, we leave here on Liberty Limited out of Washington, D.C., see? So that was the crack train out of D.C. The crack train from New York. Crack train from New York, New York.
And I thought, well, now, let's see, when was that? And when that was 1937, 38, 39, 40, 41. And I thought, well, those years, if I had been on the other side of the Atlantic and been in Brussels or Frankfurt or Dusseldorf, we wouldn't be having this conversation. So then the idea of these simultaneous train rides sort of went off in my head.
In the second movement, we hear the voices of Holocaust survivors describing their very different experiences on the appalling train journeys they were forced to make in Europe during the Second World War.
The only sounds besides the voices are whistles, train whistles, and some. And in the second movement, the movement about Europe and the Holocaust, there are some engines trying to make it up a grade and sort of groaning. Well, their whistles sound like a groan, and that was particularly appropriate for sort of pulling into Auschwitz.
The war whistle.
The third and final movement of Different Trains, After the War, is an attempt to reconcile the painful memories of the past with the present.
Are you sure?
Few contemporary composers have managed as effectively to marry such ideas with musical techniques that themselves defy the old musical boundaries.
Composers that I consider interesting are aware of this technology, are aware of these possibilities, and are using them. And I think that they're in touch with the folk music of our time, because the folk music of our time is electronic. This is what people do uncoached and unbidden in their garages, in their homes, and then eventually it becomes professional. And that is the mark of folk music. It's just urban, because we don't have much left but urban.